God laid on my heart today, last night actually, rather, to talk to you all about being a team. About being a team. And I think sometimes we fail to realize why we're here. And that's almost one of those rhetorical questions, because it could be, Sean, what do you mean, why we're here on earth, or what's the meaning of life, or whatever. And no, I think sometimes we even forget why we're here, like in this building, why we're here. I think we forget why we're in the body of Christ. I think we forget that we're part of something bigger than what we are. And God began to deal with me with several things, and with the help of the Lord, I'm going to try to get all these things out tonight. And you gotta bear with me, because there's a couple different things that we've got to hit. And I believe that we're going to start in chapter 12, probably about verse 12. And if I ask you this question, if I said, why did you come here tonight, what would you tell me? And sometimes we still know the right answer, Scott, and we say the right thing, but what would you tell me? Why do we come to the house of God? And we would say a variety of things. We would say things like, maybe, well, I come here to get a blessing, or I come here to see everybody, or I come here because I'm supposed to. That would probably be a big one for a lot of us. We think we're doing what we're supposed to do. But you want to know why we're supposed to come here? To be fed the Word's part of it. I agree with that. We're supposed to come here to worship. Feeding the Word's part of worshiping. Brother Scott.
One of my answers is sometimes to see what God is going to do.
To see what God is going to do is absolutely a good answer. And you know what? What ties directly back into that is, if we want to see what God is going to do, we have to come here to worship God.
Amen.
And I think sometimes we forget that. And what God really began to deal with me on today is that there's two things in our life as Christians that has to be forefront in our life and everything that we do. Everything. As a matter of fact, if the Lord blesses me and Missy with what I think is going on in my head, we're going to change some of the sign out front. And there's going to be a new picture on it. We'll see. But there's two things that need to be alive in our church today. This is part, I started praying a few weeks ago about a vision for the church, which I've always had a loose vision, because we know that he said he wanted broken people and people that nobody else wanted to come into this church. But yet I've not seen exactly what the next step is, and I've not seen the big goal. And so I've been seeking God, Sister Diane, about what the vision is for this church. And part of what he gave me last night and this morning was two things that has to be key to this church: worship and ministry. Ministering, I prefer to say in that case, because I want it to be more of that we're actually ministering to somebody and not just the ministry. Worship and ministry. And which ministry in a roundabout way is a form of worship, but that's not exactly what we're focusing on at the minute. And what we have to realize is that everything that we do inside of this church, has to be focused in two directions, and that's worshiping God and ministering to other people. That's our two branches. If the Lord blesses us, we're going to have a cross with two flames going around it. And they're going to be two different colors. One is going to represent worship, and one is going to represent ministry. And that's going to be part of the vision for this church in the future. Because we're going to start building these worship services around the fact that we're going to come in here with an attitude of worship, and we're going to leave here with an attitude of ministry. And I want us to realize that we're part of a team. And that team is, we're going to start talking about that team in a minute, but I want to talk about this attitude of worship for a moment. And that attitude of worship is that I need to come in here before a God, a holy God, who has been good to me this week because I've been able to get here again, Sister Diane. And I need to come in here, Sister Kathy, and I need to worship Him. I need to seek Him to say, God, how do you want me to minister this week? Father God, who are you going to put in front of me? Let me see who needs to hear your words. Let me see who I can show love to. Let me see whom I'm not thinking about or who I'm not reaching out to. Let me see those that are hurting among the body. And you know what we're going to find out if we begin to seek God in worship and ask Him how we need to minister? You know what? We're going to find that we actually grow as a body. When we begin to trust each other as a team and trust each other as body parts, then we're going to find that when one of us ain't here, it won't be just the pastor trying to check up on everybody, but it's going to be other members in the church checking up on everybody. Appreciate it. Brother Scott hadn't heard from me for a few days this week, and Sister Sheila run into him, and she said, "Hey, did Scott get a hold of you?" And I said, "No." And she said, "Well, he messaged me." He said he hadn't heard from me in a few days. And said he was checking on making sure he was all right. And I said, "Yeah, I just been busy. I hadn't looked up." And I hadn't. I've been so overwhelmed with doing chems that I've let down on all kinds of things. And I owe Sister Diane an apology. It had been a couple weeks she's been here, and I hadn't even as much as called her. I thought about her a blue million times, but I hadn't picked up the phone. And it's my failure. And I ask you to forgive me.
I wasn't home anyway.
Well, okay. But, you know, still, it would have been nice for him to get a message from me. And you know what? We get busy in our own life, Scott, and we don't think. But you know what I'm saying? We love everybody, and I feel a great deal of love for everybody when they come in here. But when we leave, we get caught up in our day-to-day grind, Sister Deanna, and we don't think about everybody. You know, we think about ourselves and our problems, but we don't think about our church body as part of it. And I want that to begin to change inside of us, because I like what Christ said. He said they're going to know who you are because that you have love for one another. And I want us to have that kind of love that we worry about each other and that we take care of each other. And I know there's a danger in loving one another. And you all who've been church hurt before know that there's a big danger in loving one another, because when you love each other and you get close to one another, you're going to hurt each other. And you say, "You can't prove that." And yes, I can. How many times did you fight with your parents? And how many times did you fight with your siblings? The closer you are to somebody, the more you love them, the more out you are to butt heads with them and disagree on things. But that don't change the fact that I love you. It don't change the fact that we don't have to agree on everything. And it don't change the fact that we're part of a family and that we're working as a family or as a unit or as a team to further the kingdom of God. I want our attitude to begin to come in on Sunday night to say, "I want to bow down at the throne of God. I want to be able to lift up my hands and praise God and say, 'Thank you, God. I love you, God.'" I want us to come in with an attitude of worship, an attitude that we lay down our gifts at the altar, not just the bad qualities of our life, but the good qualities of our life. And we say, "God, here I am. Use me to further your kingdom. What would you have me to do?" I want us to have that passion when we cross that threshold to say, "God, I'm here to worship. God, I'm here to love you." Yes, yes, yes. We're here. There's so many needs so often that when we come through these doors. I'm aware of that. And I would like to think that through our services thus far that we've proven that we'll try our best to touch those needs. And if you recall, we've had some 45-minute altar calls. And we've had long altar calls with just one or two people down praying. And we've had prayer lines where we ain't stopped till we prayed for everybody that wanted prayed for. And you know what? And that's part of what me and Missy has always been passionate about, is making sure that when we're in this building and people are under our wings, that their needs are met whenever that they need to be met, be it in the middle of the night or the middle of the day or the middle of a service. We want to make sure it's done. It ain't just about the whole big bunch of us, but it's about the individual person inside of the body that we also need to take care of. And you know, during a worship service, that's fine. Ain't nothing wrong with us praying for one another until we got every need met. But I want that attitude to come in here that when you sing a song, or when you lay hands on somebody to pray for, or when you hug their neck and tell you love them, that it's actually a form of worship to God. Because let me tell you something, anything you're doing to further the kingdom, you're doing it at the feet of Jesus to worship the Father. Can you say amen? And you know what? I want that. And you say, "Well, you mean prayer line's a form of worship?" Yes, it is, when we're obeying the Spirit. Yes, it is. Absolutely, it's a form of worship. But I also want to get us to that point that we pay attention not just to the music, but to the words of the songs. That way, when those words are sung, we can say, "I can relate to that in my life. I can relate to that in my life." I want to be... There's sometimes I hear songs, and I hear the words of that. That's the reason I listened to Christian rap. It was never to do with the music. I started listening to the words. And I started thinking, "Man, so much of those words I begin to relate to." Or didn't begin to relate to, I immediately related to, because they were true. And you know, and every time that somebody gets up, it ain't entertainment. Heaven knows I'm not built to be an entertainer. And every time we get up here, it's not entertainment, it's for worship. We're saying it to God to honor Him. And what we ought to be taking out of it is the fact that we need to be worshiping the Father along with the people singing. Listen, if you're coming to be entertained, you're in the wrong spot, because this church ain't going to be an entertaining church. It ain't been entertaining since I've been here, and it ain't going to be entertaining from this point forward. Because I'm praying for a people, Sheila, that are not pew riders. I'm praying for a people who are passionate about God and passionate about serving God, Scott, and passionate, Bert, about getting up and touching our community. That's what I want. Sister Salee, I want people that's passionate about our community. You say, why, Sean, so your church would grow? Listen. David fell to Goliath. He didn't need an army. You hear me? Our body don't have to be a big body. I just want a passionate body. I just want a functional body. I just want a body, Sister Sheila, that's willing to get up and work and do. Let me tell you something. It's a beautiful thing for all those that got to help during the Halloween thing. It was a beautiful thing. We didn't have too terribly many people stop by, but it was good, wasn't it, Bert? It was, man. Them people, we had several people talk about how welcoming we were and how they might come back to church. And one lady in particular talked about how welcoming. We had several people talking about coming back to church. And just, you know, had some good conversations with people. And it was good. And there was a lot of work went into that. That's the kind of thing we're talking about. Okay? That's the kind of thing. And it doesn't necessarily have to be something for Halloween. I mean, there's going to be a variety of opportunities that God is going to present to us. But listen, the being welcoming and the worshiping God doesn't stop inside of this building. You begin to minister when you go outside that building. We come in here to worship. We come in here to get ourselves charged. We come in here to get refueled. We come in here to give God glory and honor and praise. But our work really begins when we clear those doors, Sister Beth, and that's when we begin to touch those people that are out on the outskirts, on the fringes, that don't know the Father. That's when our work begins. This is for our benefit as much as it is to worship God, because when you get the presence of God, you get the blessings of God. But we don't worship because we want blessings. We're supposed to worship because He's worthy. And so worship and ministry will become the mainstays of everything that ICOG will do from this point forward. Can we say amen? But see, in order for us to worship, in order for us to minister, we have to realize that we're part of a team or we're part of a body. 1 Corinthians 12:12 says, "For as the body is one and hath many members, all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ." In other words, there's a lot of parts, but one body. Well, there's 206 bones in the human body, something like that, Kyle, isn't it? Some number like that. "For by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles." In other words, whether we were born into the church or whether we were just totally not even, wasn't raised in the church at all. Doesn't matter whether you're black or white. Doesn't matter whether you're, see, he goes on and says, whether we be bond or free and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. So it doesn't matter whether we're young or old. It doesn't matter whether we're black or white. It doesn't matter whether we're anywhere in between. It doesn't matter whether we've had a long church history or a short church history. It don't matter if I'm tatted from my nose to my toes. It don't matter if I've got a stud in my ear. It don't matter whether I'm wearing my three-piece suit. It's all good, because we're all baptized into Jesus Christ. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And you know what? Our body needs multiple people. There's a young man that was doing the cams with us. Brother Brandon, and Brother Brandon puts me a lot in mind of Brother John Bedwell. And y'all know Brother John, big bald-headed, tatted up, earring-wearing John Bedwell, pastor of the Little Dove Church over in Eola, Kentucky. I love Brother Bedwell dearly. He was here a couple weeks ago, and John does not look like your stereotypical preacher. Brother Brandon don't either. And Brother Brandon had made a comment about that. He had never had been in church his entire life. He had spent 30, I think he told me he had about a 30-year drug addiction. And the Lord saved him about 7 years ago, and he's been clean for quite some time now. At least He got in church about 7 years ago. He's been clean for five. He got saved somewhere in that interim. I don't remember now. I think that's what he told me. And he said, and he told the class that we were going through, he said, I was scared when I come down here that this would be a lot of traditional church people. And it would all be the kind of traditional thing. And he said, I am anything but traditional. He said, because I don't have the experience that most of you all have. He said, I wasn't raised in a church. I was never around churches. You know what I'm saying? It's totally foreign to him. But yet what he found inside that building was a bunch of people who wants to be able to reach those who are lost. Yeah, maybe we were raised in the church, but we've all had our faults and our failures. We've all been saved by Christ. And Brandon's seen a bunch of people that wanted to reach the lost. And you know what the Lord showed me that Brother Brandon was? Brother Brandon was the missing link that we needed to get from our stuffy little church pews out into the streets to get a hold of those people who are a whole lot more contemporary and modern than we are. It's people like Brandon that the Lord has pulled out of sin and mire and what we call the world that he will use to link us back to those people that need God. And you say, well, don't we have, we do have people like that? Let me tell you something. We got enough backstories in this room to reach anybody that we need to reach. Can you say amen? And you know what? But it's going to take us getting uncomfortable. It's going to take us allowing God to link us back to those people. It's going to take us realizing that people like Brother Brandon and Brother John, who don't look the part, who don't look what we think they'll look like coming in here, is okay, and they're still of the kingdom of God. And we need to take everybody that comes in that door, Sister Missy, regardless what they are, regardless who they are, I don't care who they're married to, I don't care how many times they've been married, it's irrelevant to me, Sister Sheila. And you say, well, what about homosexual couples? Bring them in. This is exactly where that God wants them to be. And you say, well, what about their sin? And I'm going to ask you, what about yours? Because let me tell you, when you get yours all under the blood, then you can start helping me help them with theirs. Hallelujah. You see, this is the kind of church that God wants us to be. He wants us to be a church that's on fire and a church that's passionate and a church that's full of love. And you say, but Sean, those things are wrong. And I'm going to tell you that all sin is wrong and God wants it all out of our life. But if they don't see us live a standard, Brother Scott, they're never going to know there's anything other than a hypocritical Christian that's got sin buried under the rug and they shout on Sunday, but they commit sin on Monday. They need to see a loving people that'll love them exactly where they are in exactly the condition that they're at, and we can love them into the cross of Christ. Can somebody say amen? Woo! Glory! But see, we can't do that if we're not in worship and ministry. We can't do that if we're not in unity. We can't bring all creeds and races and nations into this building. We can't bring all persuasions and all sins and all addictions into this building if we don't realize that we're all needed to be in unity. We are all part of one body with many members. And then I like what it begins to say in 14. He said, for the body is not one member. Watch those next two words. But many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? In other words, if the foot says, hey, I ain't going to belong to that anymore, does it change? I mean, can my foot just leave my body? I can cut my foot off and do myself a great deal of damage, but my foot just can't just get up and leave. I wonder that about my sanity sometimes, but the rest of me is attached. And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? In other words, if everything was an eye, how could we hear? If the whole were a hearing or an ear, where were the smelling? In other words, if we was all just a big ear, how could we smell? But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it hath pleased him. Let me tell you something. That right there, if you're struggling with where you are in God, that verse right there is what you need to hang yourself on. Because you say, I don't fit in or I don't belong, and I'm going to tell you that as long as you're doing your best to obey God, verse 18 is your friend. Can you say amen? Because he said he's put you exactly where he wanted you to be. Man, that's powerful. You say, but I don't do anything. I'm going to say, yeah, you do. You see, sometimes our work is more physical, sometimes it's more spiritual, and sometimes it's more of a learning phase. I had to go to school quite a while before they let me be a veterinarian. I had to sit and learn a long time. Did that mean I wasn't going to be a veterinarian? No. Did that mean I wasn't in vet school? No. It just meant I had to learn. And so sometimes our place and where God has placed us is in a position to be able to learn. And so sometimes, Bert, we hold down pew for a while before that God moves us into something else. But other times, sometimes, especially us people who really are able to get in and to hang on and come consistently, sometimes what we don't realize is our consistency is what God has us being at that moment in time. I can't tell you how many times that somebody's not showed up at church at Garrett, and then somebody said to him, said, I was so worried, you know, I look for you to be there every Sunday. Did you hear that? I look for you to be there every Sunday. Some of the youth, they said that to some of my youth. My youth was really consistent about coming, and they didn't come one Sunday. And some of the older people went to Summit, went to Sister Lindsay, I believe it was, and said, you know, said, it really bothered me you wasn't here last week. Something said, you know, I look for you to be there every Sunday. In other words, if they were not doing anything else, Deanna, they were just being consistent because, you know what? We gain strength off one another. Remember I said we're going to visit how we affect one another, we work together as a team? We gain strength off one another. See, it blesses me to be able to see you all here as often as you can. That's a blessing to me. And I expect to see you there. And then when you're not, then I worry about you. You see, and what other people do is they begin to say, you know what? If Sister Kathy's hanging on, I can hang on, because I know what she's going through. But every Sunday, she's there. And as long as she's hanging on, sometimes our work is just to be there. Just to be there. And you may not feel like you do much, but it is a lot. It's more than you realize. And we're going to come back to that. I need to read some more. But verse 19, and if they were all one member, where were the body? In other words, if we were just big one giant finger, where would the rest of the body be? But now, are they many members? Yet, but one body. In other words, we've got a lot of parts, but one body. The eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Can you say amen to that? That's pretty clear cut, Bert. Nay, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care, what's that? One for another. The body should have same care, one for another. And whether one member suffer, I love quoting, I misquote the words all the time, but this is where I refer to when I say Paul says if one suffers, we all suffer. Whether one member suffer, what's it say? All the members suffer with it. Or one member being honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now, ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. And God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondly prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles and gifts of healing, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles, have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? And the answer to those questions is no, that's not what we all do. But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. Now, we may come back to verse 31 a little bit later, but 31 basically leads into chapter 13, which is all about love and charity. And I believe I want to, there are several little things I want to hit here before we get done. And I want to go back to our works for a minute and our comely parts. And I'm just going to be honest with you now. I'm not a foot fan. Okay? Now, that don't take offense to what I'm about to say. I'm just using this as an example because he mentioned head and feet and I can relate. I can't look at my feet and tell them I don't need them. Right? And I view the feet as being a less handsome or comely part than other parts of the body. Right? And most of us would say yes. And so, even though that I look at my foot and I don't think it's maybe necessary or even good to look at, I can't tell my body that I don't need it, right? And he said there that he had given honor to the less comely parts so everything would be equal. You say, what does that mean? Preachers get a lot of glory. That's what they do. Everybody's like, oh, he's a preacher. Everybody wants to be a preacher. And that's what we put up in the churches, Sister Diane. We've always put the preachers up on a pedestal. Matter of fact, we think they're so good, we call them reverend. Now, to me, I don't be called reverend. I ain't no different than anybody else. I just got a different job. I happen to be the mouthpiece for this body. Right? That's my job. Call me the mouth. I wouldn't hardly call myself the brain. What'd you say, Diane? Thank God for mouths. We need one. We need a mouthpiece. I'm a pretty good mouthpiece, I think. I got some decent PR. My wife would probably be the brain, or at least the common sense. Because that's definitely not me. I am not blessed with common sense. She's eat up with it. I, on the other hand, am not. And so, I'm maybe the mouthpiece. But who is it that cleans our bathrooms? And who is it that vacuums our floors? Who is it that takes care of our technology and makes sure that I've got batteries in my mics when they're running out in the middle of the service? Who is it that comes in and helps with the work? Who is it that cooks food for our dinners? Who is it that comes to the altars and prays with those? Who is it that sings songs and gives testimonies? You see what I'm saying? We've all got a place in this. And even though the position, if that's what you want to call it, that we hold in the body may not be exactly what some of us would want it to be, it's still crucial to the function of the body. And the Lord said that He'd give honor to the part that didn't seem as important so that it would all be equal across the board. Because without the part that we don't like, we still need that body part in order to be a body. Can you say amen? I've got a lot of respect for those who work in a church. Because you know what? I'm going to be honest with you. I feel like I've got the easy job. Because all I got to do is come in here and let God use me. And I'm good to go. You know, that comes natural for me. That comes good for me, Sister Sheila. But you know what? There's people that get up and cook and clean. And people that will get songs and testify and pray for the church. And fast and have their heart bleed for others. And you know what? We can't do it without, Deanna. We can't do it without other people that start ministries and be led by God to do something. I'll just use a couple things that's been going on. Sister Sheila come and she said, can we do a fall festival? And the Lord kind of directed us to do that thing at Halloween. And it was clearly that God was involved. Sister Deanna come and said, you know, we're going to highlight these verses in the Bible. We're going to be able to take them to people. And we're in the process of getting that done. And you know what? Don't worry. It might seem like it's moving slow, but God's got His timing. And I have felt like for weeks that it's going to come about and it'll mature and blossom just the way God wants it to in His time. We just keep being diligent and it'll come and it'll come out of that. And see, without people, I'm the mouth, right? Those were not my grandchildren. Okay? Me and Missy, because I'm the pastor, we get up here and sing some songs. I'm not a song leader per se, and I'm not a worship leader as a general rule, especially without somebody behind me to back me up. You know, I get up to sing those songs so we can worship. Scott and Kathy gets up and sings those songs that we can worship. I mean, you know, that's what we do, right? That's part of what we do. People like Kyle and Bert, they are the backbone of so much of the labor work that is done around these churches. Listen, I can't do this without you all. Without me, I'm just a mouthpiece. And we all know how we don't like blowhards, right? And that's what I'd be. If I was a mouth without a body, I'd just be somebody running my mouth. Can you say amen? That's all I'd be. And there ain't nothing worse than somebody who runs their mouth and won't back it up. You all know that. We've all seen them in school. And they never would back it up, you know? And that's exactly what I'd be. See, we're part of a team. And we have need one of another. And yes, sometimes our roles cross. Sometimes I'll be doing the things I don't typically do, and sometimes you'll be doing the things I typically do, and we all interact, even though we all have roles. It's a lot like the military. Even though you got one guy packing a big heavy machine gun, anybody's capable of picking it up and using it, and even though one man's packing a few more hand grenades, everybody knows how to use it. You see what I'm saying? All of our roles cross. Even though we've got specializations or certain calls, the Lord will put us into the body, what? As He needs us. Can you say amen? This little church has a core, a backbone to this body. And those people in this room and a few other people are the backbone to this body right now. And without that backbone, without that core, Kyle, we wouldn't be getting nothing done. We'd be sitting stagnant, man. Just the way it was before I got here. The Lord told me earlier, Sister Diane, He said, don't be looking for the approval of man. And He said, don't be looking for what's been done, for the work to be done or for the fruit of it. He said, just obey me. Just do what you told me. I said, God, forgive me. I'll do that, Scott. I can do that. I can roll that. I've had to do that roll before. I'm a man of action. I like to see things done, and I like to see it done yesterday. I'm always looking for the next thing I can get accomplished. Accomplishment to make me. I like to get finished with something. You know what I'm saying? I like to. Don't you, Bert? I hate starting a project. And I hate the middle of a project. But I sure love when the project is done. Amen? And that's my problem. I want to start something and I want it over instantaneously. Unfortunately, God, on the other hand, has a different outlook on that. Somebody said the other day in a video I was watching for the campus program, he said, God is a farmer. And the analogy was there that He likes to plant things and He likes to watch things grow. He's not a man that will make everything happen just instantly. Now, He's capable of that, but that's often not the way that He works. And that's a whole other sermon in itself. But, you know, but these things that God is doing in this church will come to maturity. And I have felt for weeks that God was beginning, even in some of my previous sermons, to draw and drive this church in a certain direction. And today, last night and today become really clear to me. That we're a team and we have to start beginning to act like a team as much as we can. So there's no big I's and little U's. We're all equal. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We're all equal. And it don't matter how much you think I work or how much I think you work. It don't matter. That's irrelevant to that, Sister Diane. We're all part of this team together. And we've all got things that we've got to do. Now I may not use my little toe very often. But by crackies, when I need it, I need it. Because when I'm falling sideways and I can put my little toe down and keep myself from falling, I need my little toe. Deanna, you know, it may be something I think about needing all the time, but I got to have it. And my thumb, well, it's used a whole lot, but for this analogy, I'll say I may not use it a lot, but when I need a ride on the side of the road, I need my thumb. Amen. You know what I'm saying? We need our body parts. We need each and every body in this part. Now, have you ever known anybody who had something amputated? And most people who have an amputation lose a body part, it really bothers them. Don't it, Missy? We're attached to our bodies. No pun intended. But we're attached to our bodies, not just physically, but we're attached emotionally to our bodies. Now listen, I can amputate a dog or a cat's leg. They don't care. You give them 24 hours and they're standing on three legs and they're happy as a coon in a corn patch. They're not attached to their limbs. They don't get upset by that. But by crackies, you cut my pinky off and I got problems. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm bemoaning the rest of my life because I'm now down a digit. You know, life is not good. My pinky's gone. You see, that's the way that we're supposed to be about one another in our body. Our body, the word team and body is interchangeable for the sake of this conversation. Church, church body, congregation, team, whatever. You know, we're a body, we're a team, you're all members of that team or that body, of this local church, of this congregation. And listen, we ought to love one another just like we love our own body parts. And if something happened to Sister Diane back there, I ought to be mourning and upset just like I would if I had my pinky cut off. Can somebody say amen? And you know what that is? That's what Christ said, love for one another. How do you know that you've passed from death unto life? Except you have love for the brethren. Now you think about that. See, that kind of love That kind of love is not without its problems. Because if I didn't love my pinky, I wouldn't care if you cut it off, Bert. You know, as a matter of fact, you can have two or three more. I've got like 10 of them things. I don't care how many you take. Just leave me a couple so I can get my food. I'm happy. You know, that's what would happen if I didn't care about my body parts. And see, that's what happens often in churches. We only begin to care about certain body parts. Thank you, God. We only care if we have a piano player. And we only care if we have some people to sing and somebody to count the offering. We don't care about anything else. We're only in survival mode. I just need enough fingers to feed myself. I don't care about the rest of my body. And see, there's too many churches in way too much survival mode. Can somebody say amen to that? But I don't want to be a church in survival mode with just enough team members, just enough body parts to function. I want to be a full-fledged, alive and awake, living, breathing organism in the eyes of God. I want all my body parts. That means I want all of you. And I want all of you inside the body as God has set you. And that means that we'll have different roles. And that means sometimes some of us are working more than others. But that's okay. Amen? Because when I'm not working, and you are, I ought to be praying for you if I can't help you. Amen? But if you love one another, going back to that topic for a moment, because if you don't love one another, you don't care that we're gone. But if you love one another, then I'm just going to forewarn you right now that there's a risk involved with loving one another. Because you're more apt to hurt me, just like I made that analogy earlier about our families. We're going to hurt one another. But you know what? When we realize it's not our emotions that are important, per se, that it's the work that it's important, then your thoughts, if it will, when you hurt my feelings, becomes a whole lot easier for me to deal with. Because we're all after the same goal, or at least we should be. And that goal is not to keep my feelings from getting hurt. That goal is to further the kingdom of God. Can you say amen? Now you think about that for a minute. That's what we're supposed to be doing. It ain't been about us. It ain't about my emotions. It ain't about your emotions. It ain't ever been what it's about. You're supposed to be a mature Christian at this point that you can handle me if one day I say I'm snappy when you come in the door. How are you today, Brother Shawn? I don't know. I just don't want to bother. You know? Pray for me. Shut the door on the way out. Let me alone for a minute. Let me scratch my place and get glad. Don't get offended. You know? Well, he preaches on me. Well, I'm sorry. Take it up with Jesus. I'm not trying to preach on you. It's just the Word of God. You know, if it's hitting you, maybe we ought to pray about what you're doing. Don't get mad at me. You know?
Better go to the altar.
Better go to the altar. Matter of fact, if we were a whole lot more like Christ told us to be, when you have fought one with another and you go to one another, we'd have a whole lot less problems. Can you say amen to that? Because I'm going to tell you something, most of those problems ain't really problems, Scott. If you go to them and say, listen, man, you hurt my feelings, most people's going to say, what I do? I'm sorry. I mean, don't take offense to that. I'm sorry. You know? And guess what? Even if they don't apologize, you still got to forgive them and go on and do your part. You know, I get mad sometimes at my lower back and my knee because it don't do what I want it to do. And it don't behave the way I want it to behave. And some days, I get plumb aggravated at it. It's downright depressing because it just gets plumb out of sorts. But you know what? The rest of my body's got to... I can't let go of my back and my knee. And so the rest of my body's got to get up and keep on plugging. Can you say amen?
Amen.
And when God takes the notion to get it done, my back and my knee will come in line. Can you say amen? And boy, it's a good time when it does too, because then I feel like I can kick my heels up and work. Do everything else, otherwise I plug along. Do you get the analogy? When the parts of our body that ain't doing what they're supposed to be doing, we can't cut them free. We pray for them, drag them along with us, and we continue to do what God wants us to do as a team. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Alright. So, our little works are crucial. Everybody's equal, and we must love every member. Y'all down with that? There's a mathematical theorem, comment, sentence, whatever, that says something along these lines. That a number can't be greater than the sum of its parts. right? So if I add 50 plus 50 blank, it ain't going to be 102. It's going to be 50, right? Well, I got news for you. My God maybe created math, but those rules don't apply to his work.
Amen.
Because if we get together as a team in worship and ministry, and everybody is fulfilling their roles in the ministry and the worship like they're supposed to be. In other words, we're all working as a body. Guess what? 50 plus 50 don't equal 100 anymore. It equals 150. Because a body of Christ that is in unity and in the will of God will be greater than the sum of its parts. Can you say amen? And you know why that is? Because if it was equal to the sum of its parts, then it would be a man-sized thing. But when you get God involved, it ain't a man-sized thing, Bert. It's a God-sized thing. And see, that's what we fail to see so often, Dan. We're in a team, man. You just as well give us jerseys and numbers because we're all on this thing together. We're a team. Jesus Christ is our coach, and we've got a game to win, a fight to fight, whatever you want to say. We've got work to do. And I want us all to do it together. I want us to begin to become a team in unity and begin to touch our community. Can you say amen? I want us to begin to become a team and come in here and lift up the name of God together. Can you say amen? I want us to be greater than the sum of our parts. You say, you ever seen that? I see it all the time. I see it all the time, man. When I see people healed, it's greater than the sum of the parts because I can't heal nobody, but God can. When I see walls broken down around lives and tears begin to come to them, glory to God, it's greater than the sum of our parts. There was a young girl that come here several months back, and there was just a handful here that night, and I forget what the message was, but I knew in my heart when I see them come in that it was going to be for, at least in part, those people, and it was. And that young girl had not been able to sleep hardly at all since her father had died. And she hadn't even hardly been able to be out of the room with her mother that had to take her out of school because of her anxiety level, and her only in the fifth grade then, when a lot of this went down, and that young lady was really struggling. And her mother wound up in the altar that night, good lady of God, and I looked back there, and Missy had her arms wrapped around one of the little girls and praying for the other little girl, and tears just rolling on the one. And Missy was holding her, and she was just crying. And I went to the little girl who was struggling that Missy was kind of praying for too. And the Lord began to use me to say things. Ain't no glory to me. I'm testifying. And the Lord began to speak to that little girl through me. And he told her what he could do for her. And that little girl come to this altar already saved. But she come to the altar and laid down her problems at the throne of Christ. And I want you to know that that little girl is in class. And that little girl is sleeping at night. And God gets the glory. Amen. That is something great. Greater than the sum of our parts.
Amen.
That is something greater than the sum of our parts. And you know what? Listen, I don't care if we sit here 50 years, but if we're in the will of God and we change one life and save one soul and we're doing what God wants us to do, then that's greater than the sum of our parts. Because I don't care how many people I got behind me, and I don't care how close that you are to God, without God we can't save nobody. And without God we can't heal nobody. And without God I can't put no homes back together. And without God I can't have no revivals. And without God, it don't matter what I do, there's no glory to it. But when I do it with God, it's something greater. Glory. They said about Garrett, several years ago somebody spoke and said, people will say, you mean they're doing that in that little church? And that's exactly what they begin to say. Sister Diane, we went through a 5-month revival. 55 people saved and rededicated. 30-some healings that we wrote down on paper of how God had healed the body. I can't tell you how many people got filled with the Holy Ghost, something 17 or better. I seen it with my own eyes, Deanna, that laying on her hands, and people instantly began to speak in tongues, just like they did in the book of Acts. And there wasn't no praying down at the altar. These people would be standing in the aisle, and people would lay hands on them, and tongues would begin to fly out of their mouth, just like that, Scott. Wasn't it, Missy? instantaneous. It would just come out of their mouth. Let me tell you, I've seen God do more things out of that church than I... Glory. And you know what? It wasn't a big body, and it certainly wasn't no rich body, because that poor place ain't got no money just like we don't. But God certainly was in control of that body. And it, what come out of there was greater than the sum of its parts. Can you say amen? And you know what? If we'll be the team that God wants us to be in worship and ministry, then hallelujah, we can see something greater than the sum of our parts. Glory, somebody ought to give him a hand clap of praise in here tonight. Yeah. So having said all that, I think it's time we worship a little bit, don't you? I want to worship him just a little bit. Sister Missy, have you got a song or two like that? Megan, come on, bring it, book. I need something.